time to throw a color.
Okay, everyone, this is JR with the second edition of this video, and this one's going to go for a little bit because of the coloring. I wanted to tell everyone that this has been a wonderful experience with the drawing and the coloring of CM Punk, and here in just a little bit you're going to see how I draw the tattoo without the use of pencil. And I'll be honest with you, I just more or less freehand it and just get it done as best as you know I can and as quickly as I can, which honestly is actually a lot of fun. I like to do it that way. In other words, kind of kicking it old school. As my buddy Christopher Walken would say, yeah, you know, he takes the marker and he puts it down, and then he grabs the pen, takes it, and then he draws without a pencil. Wow, it's like working without a net. You know, a net was part of the Mickey Mouse Club back in the 50s, and yeah, you know, she was a big member. Prismacolors is what I use, like peach, for the flesh tone, especially for Caucasians, and then of course for other races of people, of which there are many, thank heavens. We have different colors that we use, and so that's actually pretty cool. I want to answer some questions here that were asked, and I want to say thanks to everyone who typed one in. And please keep them coming, because there will be more videos. It just won't happen until after the fall. It says, my friend Dave asked me, what compliment, what are some of the compliments that I have received from some of the wrestlers who've seen my work? Well, first of all, Dave, thanks a lot for that question. I have been very, very, very fortunate, to be honest, when it comes to my artwork and the professional wrestling world. It started when I was a kid, when I was maybe 14 years old. They were doing a meet and greet, a local meet and greet here. It was a photo op only, not autograph. And it was of, believe it or not, it was of Johnny B. Badd and Mark Miro. For those of you who don't know who Johnny B. Badd was, he wrestled for the WCW as Johnny B. Badd. He was, oh, so pretty. Oh, hush, Johnny. I tell you, I really like that character. I was a big fan of Little Richard at the time, and still am, really. Woo! And I thought he was really cool, and I thought the character was great with the 50 set. I just liked it, you know. But anyway, what happened was, is I drew a picture of him, and I knew I was going to be meeting him, and I gave him the picture. And after my mother had seen it, and my mom had a great deal to do with how I got a lot of the compliments at a young age. She told me that what I should do is put my name and address and everything on the back of the pictures. And I never thought anything about it, to be honest with you. I just said, okay, you know. And I honestly never, ever in a million of my wildest, billionest, craziest dreams would I ever have thought anything would have happened. And sure enough, a couple of weeks later, I got a sealed envelope from the WCW office when it was still at One CNN Center in Atlanta. And it was a full-color autographed picture of Johnny B. Badd. And it said, thanks for the great picture. You're a great artist and a bad man. And I thought it was really, really cool. And that was the first. And then about a year later, I got the opportunity, for me, the opportunity of opportunities. And it was to meet my idol, my hero, and my friend, now he's my friend, Ricky the Dragon Steamboat. And it was a photo op. It was just photos only. It was sponsored by the WCW and the Fox 11 Kids Club. And it was him and Dustin Rhodes. And at the time, Dustin Rhodes was still Dustin Rhodes. He wasn't Gold Dust. It was in WCW again. It was 1992. And I remember I drew a picture of Ricky. And of course, the people that were controlling the line, they saw me walking up with the paper, right? And I guess they thought I wanted an autograph. And I said, no, it's a picture I drew, and it's a gift for Ricky. And I remember giving it to Ricky, and he looked at it, and he smiled, and he said, thank you, it was very, very good. And then he folded it up and put it in his pocket, which I thought was really neat. He kept it. But again, I didn't think anything of it. I had already put in, my name and my address and everything on the back of it, again, at my mom's prompting. And sure enough, couple of weeks later, I got a letter in the mail, and it was written to me by Bonnie Steamboat, Ricky's wife at the time, and it said that I was a great artist and that I have great talent, and which to me was just blowing me away. I mean, they actually liked my work, and let me tell you something, for a 15-year-old kid, that was the pinnacle of pinnacles, you know? And then it also included she also included a signed 4x6 picture of herself and Richie Steamboat, Ricky Jr., Little Ricky. He now wrestles for the WWE's developmental NXT company as Richie Steamboat, and that kid is amazing. He's going to be as good, if not better, than his old man when he gets in the ring for the WWE on TV. And then in 1994, another compliment that I received was from Marcus Bagwell and the Patriot. At the time, they were teaming together as Stars and Stripes in WCW. And their costumes at the time, I'm not going to lie, I hated it. I thought they sucked. They looked like just candy stripers, you know? I mean, it looked terrible. It was like long, vertical, red and white lines with a blue line with stars going down the sides. And to me, I just didn't like it. And they were doing an autograph meet and greet session again through the kids club, and I go in and I'm sitting there and I'm thinking I want to draw a picture of them, because at this point in time I'm thinking, yeah, I'll just draw them a picture, why not? And I've done it for Brian Pillman. He loved the picture, and he told me that I was very talented. Again, I was a kid, and he suggested going to art school, which I never went to art school. And you know, Ron Simmons, another wrestler that I got the chance to meet, and he loved my artwork. You know, a lot of those people. Mainly from WCW, because we didn't get the WWF, WWE guys in Charleston. You know, believe it or not, there was actually a contract deal. The WCW had exclusive rights to Charleston. You know, certain cities back at the old school way of the way it was done, still in, I guess, the territory type situations, is that certain promotions could only run in certain cities. Huntington, WWF ran Huntington. They both shared Wheeling and I believe Bluefield, but Charleston was exclusively WCW's. Huntington was exclusively the WWF's. Of course, now it doesn't matter; anything goes. But back in those days, they stayed out of each other's, you know, territories. And that being said, whenever they did an autograph meet and greet of a certain wrestler, it was a WWF guy, you knew he was going to be in Huntington. If it was a WCW guy, he was going to be in Charleston. Only one time that I know of, we had a WWF guy come in to Charleston when he was actually still with the WWF, and that was Sergeant Slaughter. And at the time I just met him. I got his autograph. No big deal. But back to the Patriot and Mark Bagley. What happened was I drew a picture, and I designed my own pair of tights for them. And I did it on a whim. I didn't even set out to do it because of, I just did it because I didn't like the way their tights looked. I thought, you know, I just drew it. And it just came to me and it flowed out of me, you know, like water. It was like butter, you know? Anyway, so I drew the picture, and I remember I went to the expo and I gave them the picture, and Mark Bagwell, who had already seen my work once before and really, really loved it, he didn't remember me. Of course, he said that he did, but that was just being polite. You know, in the wrestling business, if a fan says, "Hey, do you remember me?" You always, even if you do or you don't, you always, always, always lie and say, "Yeah, man, how you doing?" You know, it's just, you know, we don't want to disappoint the fans. You know, even if you're a heel, you know, because you know, a good rule of thumb for anyone who's getting into the wrestling business: always be nice to people on the way up, because you never know who you'll need on the way down. And that's not a green light to use people. What I mean is, just be nice, you know? It's always better to be nice to people. And that's just something I've learned. But anyway, a couple of days later, because of the, you know, again, I put my phone number and my everything on the back of it, of the picture for the Patriot and Mark Bagwell for Stars and Stripes, I got a phone call from Bagwell's personal costume designer. Her name was Susie Tennis, and she lived out in Garland, Texas. And she loved my artwork. She said my rendering of them and the patriotic rendering of them was second to none. And for a kid my age, at this point I was 17, that she was just blown away, and that they wanted to make those tights real. They actually wanted to wear them because they were going on an upcoming tour of Germany. and I had to get her my written permission and all that. Well, of course, you know, I'm a kid, you know, and I'm flipping out. Oh, my God, you know, WCW and Mark Bagwell and the Patriot, they want to wear something that I drew. Holy crap. So, you know, I signed my life away, and I definitely, you know, did that. And then the biggest compliment from that was in 95, they actually won the tag team titles in those tights over Pretty Wonderful when they wrestled against Paul Roma and Paul Arndorf. And it was just the cultivation, you know. And then what happened, you know, later on in life, after I've gotten into the wrestling business, actually, this just happened last year, this year, actually. Mark Bagwell came into town, and we were talking, and he, believe it or not, he did remember me. And we talked, and of course, I drew a picture for him of my dogs, of the of him in the Patriot and the Star of the Stripes gimmick, and he loved it, and he talked about it, and said he still had the tights, and, you know, so he was actually really cool about it, so that was really neat. Other compliments that I've received from the other wrestlers, you know, and I don't mean to sound, this entire time, I don't mean to sound like a name dropper, it's just that, you know, I was asked this question, so I'm answering it, you know. But anyway, so, let me see, who else? Shane Douglas has appreciated my work.
Let's give Punk some tattoos!
Marcus Bagwell, Shane Douglas. These are just some of the guys that worked for the company that I was recently part of. And then, let's see, who else? Kevin Sullivan. Hacksaw Jim Duggan, he's liked my work. These are just some of the guys that I was able to give artwork to. Ronnie Garvin. The Barbarian, he's a trip. I really love Shione. He's one of the coolest cats I've ever met in business. For his just for his sheer awesomeness alone, I mean, I just think he's great. He's old school, you know. And if you can get him to sit and talk with you, he'll tell you road stories. And he's just a trip. And Jake the Snake, another guy who liked my work. So, and they all pretty much say the same thing, you know. You're talented. Your artwork's great, you know, and I never get tired of hearing it, and I'm grateful. You know, I just think it's really cool, you know. So I hope that answers your question, Dave. And moving on though with the coloring here. Now as you can see, I'm actually going into the drawing detail of the tattoo work on CM Punk's chest, which, you know, really is not that difficult. It's time constraining is what it is. It's time consuming, and it's actually a lot of fun. And I also really pride myself on drawing wrestling titles to where you can actually read the writing on the belts, even though it's in a smaller scale. I've always been able to draw on that small scale. In fact, when I was in high school, my art teacher used to chastise me sometimes. Not in a hateful way, but in a banter of more or less, you know, draw big, draw big, draw big. And so whenever I had to do a assignment for my art teacher in high school, I always had to do a larger picture because she knew I could do small. She just wanted to see me blow something up and make it larger. And I did, and I may have butted heads creatively, you know, with some art teachers of mine because I had my own style and I was a little hard to manage, but it was just because that's just the way I was, you know, and you know, it happens. Unlike other CM Punk pictures, you know, it's a creative process, and I like to draw. And drawing tattoos, and this has come from drawing guys like The Undertaker and people who have a lot of tattoos, you know, I like to do it. It's a lot of fun. And actually, when I used to have a art booth at a flea market, at a local flea market a few years ago, and people would come in, and if I had a dollar for everyone who came in and said, you should get into doing tattoos, you know. The thing is, you know, I tried once. I did. A friend of mine had a tattoo shop, and I went in there one night, and we were goofing off, and the vibration of the gun, I just didn't like it. You know, it made my fingers vibrate. I didn't care for it much. I don't like that. And as you can see, I drew the Pepsi logo because I'm a Pepsi lover. I love Pepsi, and CM Punk loves Pepsi, and I love when they ask him about the tattoo. That was his answer. I love Pepsi. And as you can see, I've drawn the cobra symbol on the other arm there for Punk. And those are the two big trademark no-nos that you can't even get on the figures, which makes sense. But at the same time, I wish that companies would just allow it, because the fans, you know, they want the entire figure. They just don't want part of it. You know what I mean? But the cobra tattoo leads me into another question, again asked by my friend Dave, was do I draw retro characters, you know, other than wrestling? And oh yeah, I sure do. I'm a huge, huge pop culture fan. G.I. Joe, comic books, I mean, you name it, I love it. You know, sci-fi movies, and here's a good tight shot of the tattoo work. This is just the black and white so far. I will add color later on in the video. But I draw all kinds of retro characters. And as you can see, here's me with my Pepsi, and I'm drawing the Pepsi, and thumbs up, and there you go, you know. And if you notice my t-shirt, I am a proud card-carrying member of the Blue World Order. We are taking over! Who else do I draw? I draw everybody. You name it, you know. And coming up for the ShockerCon, which is Charleston's answer to the Comic-Con, only I think, you know, in Charleston, this is one of the biggest events of the year. And it's going to be awesome. We're going to have, you know, actors and celebrities galore. It's going to be really cool. And I've been drawing around the clock, basically, for this thing. And I'll draw anything. The only two things I won't do, because of the copyrights, and you never know who's out there, you know, and this is a good rule of thumb for any commercial artist. Stay away from, there's three things. Stay away from Harley Davidson, because their copyrights are extremely, extremely huge. Stay away from Disney, they're the big one. And stay away from Garfield. I mean, Garfield, Jim Davis, I don't know if he still does, but I know he used to live on Myrtle Beach. And if you go down Myrtle Beach on the Strip, it's lined with airbrush artists and local artists selling their wares. And what he will do is he'll, you know, because he's not real publicly known. I mean, he's not real. He keeps himself out of the spotlight. So if he walked up on you, chances are you wouldn't know who he was. And what he does is he will actually walk up and see what kind of things you're selling. And if you're selling his product, he will ask you to stop. You know, and if you don't stop, well, then he can have you prosecuted and all that. Can you imagine, just for a minute, can you imagine you get arrested and you get prosecuted and you get put in jail for drawing Garfield? I mean, you get thrown in a cell with, you know, some crazy axe murderer, and he looks at you and he goes, "What are you in for, bub?" And you go, "I drew a cat, but I used a really big pencil, man. You know, don't mess with me." I mean, can you just imagine being arrested for something as silly as drawing Garfield? But yeah, I do draw a lot of other characters, and that's just something that I do. I've always done it. As a matter of fact, I that's how I started drawing, was drawing G.I. Joe, drawing Batman, drawing Star Wars. You know, I love lightsabers. I think Star Wars is the greatest thing ever. I'm so stoked for the new movie. I can't wait for Episode 7 and 7 and 8 and then going into 9. Hopefully, George Lucas will do an even dozen of Star Wars movies, and then even beyond, you know. My buddy Troy asks me, what's the most difficult thing I've ever drawn? Well, I'd have to say, when I was doing caricature maps, and caricature maps are those maps that you see, they're all hand-drawn, and they're usually done of a town or a city. I did those for a while, a couple years back, and to be honest with you, I hated it because it was extremely difficult. It wasn't so much time-consuming as it was I had to get things precise, and the person that I was with, that I was doing the artwork for, was extremely picky, and that, for me, is the biggest pet peeve. When someone I'm working for, if I have a client, and they're extremely picky, and no matter how you do it, you can't seem to please them, that is when it gets frustrating, and that's when it gets difficult, and that is something that I truly, truly hate. Sometimes you can't, and it's true, you can't please everyone, but if you get someone and you know that they're going to be hell-bent on being difficult, well, then there's really nothing you can do. You know, I mean, no matter how you do it, you're not going to please them. And so that is what happens, and that is what happened with drawing those maps. I would never do it again. ever, because again, it was just time consuming and I didn't like it, so I won't do it again. I did it once. I think I've got two maps out there somewhere in the state of West Virginia. I know one of them is of the town of Elizabeth, where the claim to fame to Elizabeth is that Jesse Lynch, she was a POW war veteran. That's where she was from. Actually drew her house as part of the caricature map. It was actually pretty cool. And they paid well, but again, it was just too much BS, I guess, you know. My friend Chris asks me, what's my favorite pick that I've ever drawn? What's my favorite thing I've ever drawn? Well, whenever I get the opportunity to draw Ricky Steamboat, it's always my favorite, because Ricky Steamboat, again, is my hero. Quick side note here. Here I'm actually using a whiteout pen, and this is great for detail work. This is fantastic, especially if I want to do like diamonds or shine or add shine to something. Always use a whiteout pen. It's amazing work, so it's a good tip for you young artists out there. Yeah, my favorite picks always include Steamboat. I'm a huge Steamboat mark. I love Ricky, and he is a friend of mine on a personal level. I mean, we're not bosom buddies, and I'm not saying he would know me out of a crowd, but I am saying that if we hung out for a second and I reminded him who I was, because you got to think, man, he goes everywhere, he sees a lot of people. And yeah, Ricky's a class act all the way. And going back to what I said earlier about, hey, do you remember me? And some wrestlers will say, oh yeah, sure, you know, and I said, you know, to lie. You know, but if, you know, Ricky actually legitimately does remember people. Ricky is probably one of those rare guys who legitimately does remember the fans, you know, and he's always a class act. He always has time for you. He always stops. He always autographs things. And he's one of the real, genuine good guys out there. I can't say enough good things about Ricky Steamboat. He's the best. But, so drawing him has always been my favorite. As you can see, I'm working here. I always end up holding four or five markers in one rip. You know, here I got three. It's just easier for me. You know, I like to have things at a arm's reach length so I can grab it and color with it. And going on here, as you can see, I'm now adding color to the tattoos. And, you know, it's a lot of fun. You know, I love to do this. I adore drawing. And this video concept actually came to me, you know, like I said in the first video. You know, I was watching another artist. His name is Todd Nock. He's an amazing comic book artist. I think he's great. I love his style. I thought, well, you know, I got this page on on Facebook, and I might as well go ahead and try it and do this. And then it turned out to be well, and I didn't know who to draw for my first video. And then my friend Eugene, who I'm drawing this picture for, CM Punk, who actually he should have this in his hands probably by Monday. Is going to get this actually autographed at Wizard World, Wizard Con, by CM Punk. So along with a lot of other wrestlers, including Ricky Steamboat, who's going to be there. So that's pretty neat. A few other WWE guys are going to be there too. But you know, drawing has always been, for me, it's therapeutic. You know, if I'm having a real crappy day, or if I just need to get away from things, you know, because, you know, I mean, I'm honest with everyone. I have manic depression, and I have bipolar disorder. And when I am having issues, or if I just need to be alone, you know, or things are just getting on my nerves, you know, going into my office, I put on my headphones, I get lost in my music, and I start drawing. And before I'm done, before I realize that I have five or six pictures drawn, not colored, but drawn, coloring takes a little bit of a longer period, you know. It does. It takes a while, because, you know, you have to color things, especially if you're coloring things like CM Punk's tattoos. CM Punk's, drawing them is one thing, but then you've got to get in there and lay in the color. And the color takes time, because you have to make sure it matches everything that is on him. You know, you have to get it as realistic as possible, as close to how it looks as possible, you know. Some people aren't picky, but I prefer you get it done right the first time, and then it's finished. You know, you don't have to worry about someone coming by and saying, this doesn't look right, you know. Getting into drawing caricatures, for me, I like to draw caricatures of people. And coming up at the Shaka Con, my friend Chris, who is a barn member, and he came up with the idea. He gave me the name, so I give him full credit for the idea for the name. Scaricatures. And what I do is I actually make people into monsters, you know. I mean, I'll draw them, and it looks like them, but we have fun with it, you know. And a lot of the kids, this is mainly for kids, you know, but some adults get into it too. If I sit down and draw them, I can make them a werewolf or a vampire or whatever, but if they ask for a zombie, I mess them up big time. And as you can see, there's the tattoos, there's the looks like diamonds with the white work that I used, and now I'm adding some more details to the belt. Again, I like to pride myself on the belts, and I'm adding some of the wording on CM Punk's fingers. I didn't do as much on the detail as that because I just, you know, and here I'm adding the crisper line with the broader tip marker of the Sharpie. It just gives it a more complete look, I think, and I like the way it makes things look, you know, it makes things look like it's actually, you know, and here's my plethora, jefe. Would you say I had a plethora of Sharpies? Si, guapo. You got a plethora of Sharpies. Jefe. Si, guapo. What is a plethora? But now, as you can see, I got a bunch of Sharpies. And those are the main markers that I use for color. I use Crayola, too. Crayola is very, very vibrant. And they're great for off-the-wall colors because, you know, Crayola is always making different colors and things like that. And then I use Sharpies because Sharpies has that permanent feel to it. Of course, you know, Sharpies are permanent markers, and I just, you know, they've been making more and more different colors here recently. I guess they're realizing that more and more artists are using their product, and it's great. You know, I love to do it, and I'll always use Sharpies because I just think they're great, you know, and I love to use them for that reason, for coloring and things of that nature, for the flesh tones, though. However, I always use Prismacolors because basically they're the best. I mean, you can't beat those. You can get colors for every flesh tone there is under the sun, you know, whether it's Asian, whether it's African American, whether it's Caucasian, whether it's Seamus, whatever in the world he is. You can, you can, yeah, I hear you there, fella. Yeah, there, you know, that's one of the dangers of working with Sharpies, is that when, you know, they have this. They're aromatic, let's put it that way. They have a very unique odor. And I'll be sitting there working, you know, with them extremely close to the... I'll be down there working with them, and I'm used to it now, but I'll be honest with you. When I was younger and I started working with Sharpie, whoo, you talk about dizzy. And, of course, that's a big Sharpie. That's the Magnum. That's the Magnum of Sharpies, and there's me goofing off again. Listen, kids, don't ever huff your markers. That was just me goofing off. I don't really huff my markers. Huffing is bad, drugs are bad, so please don't do that. Don't try that at home. There's my disclaimer. I was just goofing off. I wasn't even breathing. I had it up to my nose, but I didn't inhale. And we're coming to a close on this picture. As you can see, now I'm coloring in the framing part of the picture. And again, the reason why I do that with the black framing around and then the red around it again is because when it gets framed at someone's house, they get the full picture. It doesn't get cut off because of I drew it all the way out to the edges. I think you know, boxing it in, it just makes it more symmetrical. There's the word I'm looking for. Yeah, symmetrical. You don't screw it up, you know. You do it that way. And then it just looks better. And as you can see on my drawing board, I use a lot of black. If you can look at that big, massive splat there all over the place. And I also will sit there and I'll, if I need to figure out how to write a word or spell a word, I'll actually mark it down on there. And I do that all the time. Or if I need to do a quick math problem. So I use my artboard for many, many uses. And there's that. Now I'm going to start working in on coloring the words. Isn't it pretty? Isn't it pretty? And what I do, when I sign my artwork, I kind of touched on it in the last video, but here I'll take the opportunity to talk more about it. When I do sign my artwork and the piece is done, and I never sign the piece before it's finished, but when I go to sign my work, I always include two dots, and those are representative of my sons. My boys, Jack and Dalton, who are my entire world. I love my kids more than anything in this world, and I always want to include them in my artwork, and luckily, my boys are starting to show an interest in drawing, especially my youngest one, Dalton. He likes to draw. Of course, right now, he's drawing the zombies and the plants, and I don't know, he's really into plants versus zombies, which I just think is... You know, hey, when I was a kid, it was Mario, you know, and I'm actually older than Nintendo, so there I'm dating myself. But, you know, hey, it's all in what the kids like nowadays, you know? What's really cool is that they're you know, they've got an interest also into the Ninja Turtles, which was big when I was a kid, you know? And I can hang with them on that level, you know? I can tell them all about the Ninja Turtles and what they're like and all this and that. I am signing the picture, and as you can see, there's the two dots. So let it focus. There's the two dots. There's my Jack. There's my Dalton. And that's how I sign my pictures. But going back, when I was Sir Alfred, who came all the way from England, and there's the finished product of CM Punk, Best in the World, and there's the colored tats and all that, and there's the Best in the World logo. I drew a picture of the Iron Sheik. Iron Sheik, the Sheik, and the Hulk Hogan. Jabroni, ha, Hulk Hogan, ha, break your back and make you humble. He signed a drawing that I did, and it sold for like $25. It was really cool, and because he signed it in front of the fans. Here on the back of my pictures, I always title it. I sign my name. Right here, I write it out. And then down here, I do my my Russell graphics. And I always sign it the same way. I kind of like doing the handwritten look. I think it makes it feel more personal. And then I do the little arrow pointing down because Alfie Graphics is a derivative of Alfie Graphics. And then over here to the far right, I always sign my name in a big, flashy, loopy way. And I date it. There's the dots. And there it is. So thanks for watching. I hope you guys enjoyed this video. And have a great night. Bye.
I am the best in the world.